Hey, what's up y'all? I am BrambleGaming, home of the gaming. And holy heckaroni, pastaroni, mamma mia, papa pia, I never thought I'd see this day. Super Mario Maker 2, not just a port mind you, a freaking sequel, is coming to Nintendo Switch in 4 months. I'm still completely shocked that this is even happening, like a part of me is still convinced that this isn't real and that I'm just dreaming. But man, somehow it's real, and not only have we gotten this announcement along with the reveal of the second best game of the year being Tetris Battle Royale, I mean come on man, that's obviously like a contender for game of the year, but we've gotten such a heaving truckload of new information as to what they've added in this sequel. It's almost overwhelming and just mind-blowing how much new stuff there is. So to help with that, I've literally stopped everything that I've been doing and made this impromptu video, where I'll be analyzing this new trailer second by second to show you guys every single new thing that I found, and then afterwards talk about what I still hope gets revealed or added later on. Also, if you want to see me flip out when this first got announced earlier today, as well as my reactions to the other parts of the Nintendo Direct, you can check that out on my gameplay channel with the link in the description and at the end of the video. Anyways, without further ado, let's jump right in. So for the first few seconds of this trailer, we can see gameplay of a level in the Super Mario World style, as Mario is running through it and eventually lands on Spiny's, causing him to die. There's really nothing new that's been announced here, but once the screen switches to the editor mode, wall and handheld mode, that's when all the crap starts to go down. Right off the bat, we're shown this new editor HUD, and man is it looking fresh. Let's start off with the top part of the display where it shows the usual taskbar with the different objects that you can place in this level. Nothing really has changed here except that the objects now have colors above them to indicate what type of object group they belong to, whether it's terrain, enemies, or something else. Keep that in mind as we'll expand upon that idea later. To the left of the screen, we can see that there's new icon placements for the game style of the level, the theme of the level, and the timer for the level. In the first Mario Maker, these indicators tended to be scattered around the HUD, but in this new one, they're conveniently placed all in a column on the left side. Below the theme button is a new type of button that resembles a camera with a pair of eyes on it. Now, I wasn't exactly sure what this icon meant at first, but if we jump ahead in the trailer, we can learn about its functionality. At around 50 seconds into this trailer, we can see the player dragging a bird icon across the screen with the text of custom scroll to the left of this, clearly indicating that there's actually aspects of the auto scroll that we can now customize. Now, if you look at the same icon at the left of the screen during this section, we can see that it is actually changed to a bird, and the circular icon next to that button is now lit up as well, with a feather bouncing up and down. So my conclusion from this is that this icon can change the type of playstyle the level presents, whether it's a free moving level or an auto scroll level, with new abilities to customize how the auto scroll works. Now that we've gotten that out of the way, there's still two more new icons on this tab in the HUD that we haven't even covered yet. The first being a button which has an icon of a road leading to a flag on it. Now here's my theory on this button, and I actually have a bit of evidence to back it up. I believe this button actually lets you customize how a player can beat your level. Now hear me out on this. If we yet again skip to future portions of this trailer, we can see that the icon changes as we go along. At one point, we can see that this button has a coin indicator on the right side with the number 100, and at another point, we can see the same thing except that the number is now at 50 coins instead of the former. Now, I actually think that this button enables an option that allows you to complete a level by collecting a certain amount of coins instead of just beating it by reaching a flagpole. Think about it, the red flag was an icon that was used to indicate the end of a level in the first game, so this button clearly has to do something with adjusting how players complete a level. On top of this, during gameplay, we can see an extension of this idea, as by looking in the top left, we can see a new overlay indicator that shows how many coins a player has collected out of how many they need to collect. In this case, the player has collected 4 coins out of 50. I don't think this is merely an optional limit to how many coins there are in a level, since that basically would be useless as coins were almost decorations in Mario Maker 1. They didn't really have any purpose to get them. But if this button does what I think it does and allows levels to be beaten when the player collects a certain amount of coins, then that would actually give the coins meaning in a sandbox game like this. Plus, it'd be dope as heck. Imagine the different types of levels that players could create with this. Anyways, we've covered all but one of the icons on the left side of the HUD. I've already explained the buttons for the game style, theme, and time. We've come to the conclusion that the camera button adjusts free roam versus auto scroll, and I've taken a guess that the flag icon below the timer lets you customize how to beat a level. There's still one new button we haven't covered yet, being the round yellow button that shows a green and red player next to the motion tracker for Mario. The functionality for this button is still a mystery, as it's never shown used during this trailer. But from other stuff later in the trailer, I believe that this button either enables cooperative play on a level, or lets you switch between Mario and Luigi. However, from just the icon itself, I'm pretty sure it's the former, since they definitely have been hinting at multiplayer for this game. With that said, that's all of the new stuff for the HUD shown here. When looking to the right of the HUD, we can see that the race and undo buttons are quick mapped to the L and B buttons respectively, but there's nothing new there. Anyways, yeah, that's all of the changes to the HUD, until we go a few more frames ahead and see an entirely new select screen for the objects you use when creating a level. Ooh boy, strap in because we've only scratched the surface regarding what's new and what's changed in this sequel. If we look at the top of the screen, we can see that all of the objects usable are now sorted into different categories. Enemies, items, terrain, and the fourth unnamed category, which from the icon is probably something like gadgets. We can also see that each of these categories are sorted into pie-shaped wheels, with either one or multiple wheels for each category. For the first category, namely being enemies, we can see that a lot of the ultimate enemies used in the first game are back. Koopa Troopas, Galoombas, Cheep Cheeps, Bloopers, Spiny, Buzzy Beetles, whatever these guys are called, Piranha Plants, Chain Chomps, Hammer Brothers, Monty Moles, Thwomps, Monty Moles, but they are throw wrenches, and the Munchers all make a return in the sequel. Of course, there are many more enemies than this, as we can see at the top of this page that there are four different wheels of enemies in the category. Sadly, they don't reveal all the wheels, but we can definitely say that this is not all the enemies that are accessible. Next up, in the items category, the only new item to appear here is actually coined with the number 10 on it. From the implications of New Super Mario Bros. 2, this new type coin is most likely worth 10 regular coins, making it sort of a mega coin. This would actually serve a lot of functionality if players could beat levels by getting a certain amount of coins, as discussed earlier. And then, in the last category, we can see three new types of items, namely the on and off switches, the colored blocks that correspond to these switches, and snake blocks, which is also an awesome addition to the sequel. Now, regarding the first two new blocks here, I'll explain how they function later on in this trailer, as it actually shows in depth these new blocks being used. Once the player selects the slopes to add into the course, we can see that on top of the length of the slopes, the angle at which the starting and ending blocks go is also customizable, which can lead to some pretty cool aesthetics if you want to build some islands in a course or whatnot. And here we can see that the player extending the slope to reach the bottom of the screen. Right after this, the editor zooms out extremely far to show a much larger scope of the level. This is actually a new mode in the editor, which by reading the text in the top right corner, we can tell that this new mode is called View Mode, and is triggered by either pushing in the L stick or the R stick. This is actually really nice and should make editing levels a lot more convenient. Then, as the trailer moves on, we can see Mario sliding down the slopes, confirming that this functionality is also indeed returning. And so Mario slides down some slopes, hits a question block, and then it's all like, Super Mario Maker 2, baby! And then all of the new crap comes at you at such a fast speed. So let's try and slow it down by explaining these upcoming gameplay scenes second by second. First of all, we get an incredibly catchy remix of the Super Mario World Overworld theme, which will probably end up being one of the music tracks in the editor mode. Like, seriously, this remix is really bopping. In the same selection of gameplay that this new remix begins playing, we can see either a new object or enemy on screen, which resembles a smiling wisp of cloud slowly rotating as it goes from side to side. This enemy or object creates an updraft while doing so, which Mario then uses to reach higher portions of the level. I'm not too sure if this enemy or object has been used in the past games, but as far as I know, I'm pretty sure it's brand new. Let me know if I'm wrong down in the comments below, because it is entirely likely that I am. In the next portion of gameplay, we can see Mario in the Super Mario Bros. 3 style with an entirely new theme, namely the desert theme. In this level, Mario is riding on an extremely large floating platform on rails, being chased down by the Angry Sun, which is a new enemy to Mario Maker but originated in the original Super Mario Bros. 3 game, and it's nice to see him finally return. After this, we can see another new type of level theme, this time for the winter theme in the new Super Mario Bros. U style. This section of gameplay actually shows the functionality of the snake blocks more in depth, as it can be seen that the player is customizing the path that it takes by dragging the arrows in whichever direction that's desired. The snake block is then shown following this exact path in the testing mode, with new glimpses of the background and snow ambience in this new theme. Next up is an incredibly large reveal, as we can see the use of rising and falling water in Super Mario World with the jungle theme, which is yet again a brand new theme to this game. Now, this doesn't actually confirm that water can be placed anywhere in this game, rather it seems sort of like a pre-made level gimmick with the way that the water behaves in this level. Hopefully water will be customizable, but this is all we have to go off of at the moment. Also, the Cheep Cheeps in this level are jumping as normally as they would in an overworld level, except that instead of jumping from the bottom of the screen, they are jumping from the height of the water. Then we can finally see how the remaining two new gadget blocks in the sequel work in the next section of gameplay, and the theme is Super Mario World yet again. Here, Mario jumps off of a conveyor belt to hit a red switch, which, after being hit, makes all the red blocks disappear and causes all the red switches to turn into blue switches. We can also see that hitting the switch triggered some blue blocks to appear further on. As Mario progresses through this level, he hits another one of these switches, which in turn causes the blue blocks to disappear and the red box to reform, turning the switches to red once again. This is actually a really cool gimmick, and I'm sure a lot of people will end up using this to create some awesome levels, and I'm also sure that a lot of people will use them to make the worst levels in existence. That's just how Mario Maker works. Next up, we're provided with auto-scroll footage that we've already slightly covered, where it shows the player dragging a numbered bird icon onto the screen that has two arrows next to each other beside the bird. Right after this, we can see that auto-scroll and the level move diagonally, so I'm pretty sure that these birds will be used to customize the angle of the auto-scroll for different parts of the level. Who knows, you might be even able to adjust the speed of the auto-scroll mid-level. That would definitely explain the arrow button next to the bird. And then we finally get to the first few frames of the biggest reveal for this trailer, a new game style for the game Super Mario 3D World, which honestly looks amazingly good. Right here on this frame of the trailer, we can see how a lot of the items and objects will look in this specific game style. Specifically, we get glimpses at the spikes, glass pipes and pipes, cloud blocks, key coins, and number 10 coins, as they're the assets in these frames that seem to have changed the most. A whole lot of the other items in this frame share similar looks to that of New Super Mario Bros. U. Then, once the player swaps to the item menu, we can see two new enemies off the bat right on the right of the screen, specifically the Cheap Chomp and the Buzzy Beetles, as well as a reskin for the Goombas for this new game style. Man, do they look odd. Then we also get glimpses at, yet again, more new enemies, all of which are enemies from Super Mario 3D World. Hop Chops, Piranha Creepers, Skip Squeaks, Sting Bees, and Bullies can all be seen as selective enemies on the second wheel for this category. However, in this style, enemies only have 3 wheels instead of 4, which does sadly confirm that some enemies and assets are exclusive in certain game styles. I was hoping that wouldn't be the case, but it definitely seems like that is the case. After this, we get a much better look at the 3D World backgrounds, which also look absolutely just fantastic. The specific background for the overworld seems to have been inspired by the very first level in that game, namely 1-1 Super Bell Hills. Next up, when the player is shown dragging a giant piranha plant on the screen in a zoomed in version of the editor, we can see that a new option screen also pops up with it, allowing the player to switch between a fire piranha plant and a regular one, as well as adding and removing mushrooms, parachutes, and wings. By the way, that is also a new addition to the game, the ability to add parachutes to enemies to allow them to slowly fall out of the sky. In the next portion of gameplay, we can see that Super Bell trees are also placeable, and that you can place specific items and power-ups within them, such as... Wait, is that the Super Bell? Yep, that's right, the Super Bell is also being added to the game, allowing Mario to climb up walls and pounce on enemies like he did in the Super Mario 3D World. We can also see in these 3D world levels that the game takes on more of a 2.5 dimensional look, which absolutely fits this style, since 3D World was originally a 3D game, hence the name. We also get a look at the desert biome for 3D World in this sequel, with heat waves, trees, and flowing sandfalls in the background. After this, the trailer shows us a glimpse at the underground theme for this same game style, which also has an incredibly nice background to it, with torches and glass pipes visible while running through this level. On top of this, we're shown that the Piranha Creepers essentially act like snake blocks in the way that the player can customize the route they take through the editor. Gameplay of the Piranha Creepers is revealed next, and we can see that they act almost identically to how they were in the original game. And the next thing we're shown in the trailer is a new type of block that continuously spawns new blocks on top of old ones the more that you hit it. This is also an object that was used in 3D World, but not that often, so it's nice to see its inclusion in this game. After this, we get to see yet another theme in the Super Mario 3D World style, this time for the underwater section. Also, the new glass pipes are used in this section of gameplay, which we can see from the editor that they sort of work like rails in the way that you drag and extend them. On top of this, the physics for these pipes were shown, where apparently fireballs can travel through these glass pipes and out to kill enemies, a gimmick that was yet again present in 3D World. Essentially, the same engine seems to be running for these 3D World levels, but they're sort of just converted to 2D, so it's sort of like a hybrid and it's very interesting, so just keep that in mind. This next shot is an incredibly cool one, as it shows off a brand new theme for the Super Mario 3D World, this time a carnival-esque theme. I'm assuming this theme is exclusive to the 3D World game style, but if not, then they'll be extremely cool. A new type of bonsai bill is also shown off where the cannons are off in the back of the screen, and they fire toward the player from that position. Cat Mario seems to be walking on a new asset for the conveyor belt in this shot, which looks incredibly nice, and then is shown climbing up a new type of railing background platform. And then after all these 3D world clips, the trailer then switches back to the Super Mario Bros. 3 style and shows off a new type of moving platform for the Mario Maker series, one that will apparently rock back and forth as it travels along the rail. Nothing else needs to be noted here except for the coin counter at the top, which is no longer at an interval of 50, but instead at a limit of 120 coins, showing off how customizable this potential coin goal gimmick can be. Directly after this, we're shown an upwards auto-scrolling level in the style of Super Mario World, potentially and hopefully hinting at the option of being able to make vertical levels on top of horizontal ones. And yes, to the left of Mario is finally a pipe that isn't green but is instead colored red, confirming that pipes will come in different colors, thank goodness. On top of this, this pipe is spawning buzzy beetles with parachutes, showing more in depth how these parachutes will work when attached to enemies. Instead of immediately spawning with one attached, the buzzy beetle will hop out of the pipe without anything, and then after 1 second deploy the parachute. And then we're presented with a gameplay of yet another new theme in the Super Mario Bros. U style, this time with an outwardly space theme, most likely inspired by the special worlds unlocked in such games. We're also presented with an acid pit, which is a new hazard for Mario Maker, but nothing new for the Mario series itself. And finally, in this last shot of gameplay, we're probably hit with the most info out of all the clips in the game. First of all, we're shown the last new type of theme for a level in this game, specifically the jungle theme in the Super Mario 3D World game style. Down at the bottom, we can actually see two cheap chomps in action, whereas before we only saw them on the item select screen. We don't actually ever see them jump out of the water, but they do seem to sort of follow Mario, at least for a while. A few frames ahead of that, we're presented with the first newly revealed boss for this game, namely the easiest boss of the series, Boom Boom. His attacking tendencies do seem to be extremely similar to that of 3D World, and less similar to how we acted in New Super Mario Bros. U. On top of the screen, we can see Goomba and a Koopa Troopa traveling through a glass pipe, confirming that enemies do also interact with these objects. And then finally, after Mario bounces off of a Bonsai Bill, which is also a new addition, we get the faintest glimpse of a Fire Brother in the top right corner of the screen. Sadly, we don't get to see any of his attacks before it fades out, but it's nice to see that this variation of the Hammer Brother did make it into this game. And then, after all of that, the game title cuts in and my boy Luigi is there. About time, my man. Alright, I think that about does it for all the new stuff and changes that I've noticed. Of course, I am extremely hyped for this game, and it only comes out in 4 months or so. I'll be heavily following the trailers for this game, so if y'all ever want to see another analysis video for upcoming trailers, then just let me know. Also, I'm going to be asking you guys in a poll in the top right corner what type of content you guys want to see from me when this game comes out. Do you want to see more remixes, more original level showcases, more top 10s? Make sure to vote in that card in the top right corner. As for my overall thoughts on this game, I'm just happy, man. They've added so much more new stuff and changed the old stuff that people had gripes about in the old one, such as slopes, new bosses, new themes, new enemies, better HUD, co-op mode, hopefully. It's just so good. I seriously hope that they do fix the online though. I don't want to have to play through like 11 levels of garbage again to get to one good level anymore. Also, I do hope that they extend the limit of the levels that you can have on your system, or just the limit of like how long a level can be. But those are literally my only 2 or 3 wants for the game right now. Everything else, I'm just hyped as heck for. It totally makes sense though that Nintendo decided to wait this long to release Super Mario Maker 2. If they had released the Super Mario Bros. U port after this game, there would not have been nearly as many buyers as the other way around. So financially speaking, this move by Nintendo is smart on their part. I'm not sure what they're going to do with the first game servers, but I do hope they leave them up and don't terminate them for crying out loud. Anyways, that's the gist of it, and I'm tired as crap, so I'ma end it off here. I hope you enjoyed this impromptu video, though, and with all that said, make sure to like and subscribe to not miss any more Mario content in the future, and be sure to drop on my channel when it releases. We'll be doing a crap ton of stuff when it does. Anyways, with all that said, BrambleGaming, over and out.